I welcome you all for the lecture number 3 in module number 10. In this lecture, we will be discussing about the pneumatic comparators. We will study about the need for pneumatic comparators. They are also known as air gauging equipments. We will also study about the working principle of pneumatic comparators and what are the different kinds of circuits available and what are the various components used in pneumatic comparators. We will also study about a commercially available gauge, that is Solex gauge, and then we will move on to the important characteristics of pneumatic comparators. Then we will discuss about the advantages and disadvantages of pneumatic comparators. Finally, we will see some applications of pneumatic comparators. Now, let us study why there is a need for air gauging circuits or pneumatic comparators. Basically, they are non-contact type of comparators, and because of this, they offer the advantages of improved workflow, increased productivity, and decreased downtime. They are ideal for measuring dimensions with tolerances smaller than 0.1 millimeter. And when gauging very tight tolerances, a resolution as small as 0.001 millimeter can be achieved. Its non-contact characteristic makes air gauging particularly useful for checking very soft materials, highly polished surfaces, components with highly polished surfaces, the components with very thin walls, and other delicate materials. In case of delicate materials and very workpieces with highly polished surfaces, if we use contact type comparators, then the scratches may appear on the workpiece. So in that case, in such cases, non-contact type comparators are desired. So pneumatic comparators offer that particular benefit of not making any scratch on the workpiece surface. Now let us study about the air gauge principle. So in this diagram, you can see there is a workpiece with the surface. This is the surface of the workpiece, and we have a nozzle. So this is the gap between the nozzle and the workpiece. Now, when the air gap or the clearance between the workpiece and the nozzle increases, the flow of air through the nozzle increases. And when the clearance reduces or the air gap reduces, the pressure increases. So, this characteristic is used in the pneumatic comparators. Now let us study about the different types of air gauging circuits that are available. The first one is the back pressure circuit. You can see in this diagram, this is the workpiece, this is the nozzle, and this is the air gap or clearance between the workpiece and nozzle. And we have the compressed air supply, and there is a pressure regulator. So desired pressure can be set using this regulator, and there is a restrictor to restrict the flow of air. Now when the gap between nozzle and workpiece is high, the air flow is easy. The air escapes easily into the atmosphere, and little pressure is developed in the system. Now, when the workpiece moves towards the workpiece, or in other words, when the size of when this particular size increases, that means the gap, air gap reduces, the escapement of air is restricted. So a back pressure is developed in the circuit, which is indicated in this gauge. So the development of back pressure is used in this is used to indicate the dimensional feature in this particular circuit. Now there is another circuit in which air flow is measured. Again, we have the air plug gauge, wherein we have two jets. Now say this is the workpiece. And then this particular dimension, say D, is to be checked. This D is to be checked using this pneumatic comparator. Now we have the pressure regulator, and then there is a air flow meter. For example, rotameter can be used in such applications. In the air flow meter, we have a float. Now, when the gap between the plug and the workpiece reduces, the air flow is restricted. That means air flow reduces, so float level reduces. When this gap increases, air flow will increase, air will escape freely, hence air flow increases, the float level increases. There will be a scale fixed on the air flow meter. So by knowing the position of the float with respect to the scale, we will come to know about the size of the workpiece. Now let us study what are the various components used in the pneumatic comparators. Essentially, the comparator requires a precision air regulator to provide a constant pressure air supply to the system, and then the different kinds of toolings are needed, like plugs, rings and other shit, depending upon the work to be inspected. These toolings deliver a specific airflow or pressure to the surfaces being checked. An amplifier is another essential component used in the pneumatic comparator, and this amplifier can be an air electronic column, or it could be a dial type meter, or it could be a flow meter tube, for example a rotameter. The amplifier provides visual representation of the size being measured, permitting the user to take readings quickly and accurately. Now in this photograph, you can see a pressure regulator. This is the pressure regulator with filter to clean the air supplied air. And then this is the knob to adjust the air pressure. And they adjust what is the level of pressure that is available in the system can be noted down by this pressure indicator. And setting masters are used to calibrate the comparator. Depending upon the system, one or two masters, usually in the form of discs or rings, are used. Masters are typically made from alloy steel or tungsten carbide. So you can see here, one set of setting masters are used to calibrate the system, one for setting the upper limit of the workpiece and another for setting the lower limit of the workpiece. Now this is a close view of setting master. You can see here, this is for a particular dimension, that is 102.01 millimeter. This is the desired size of the workpiece, or the basic size of the workpiece. And this particular setting master is used to set the upper limit, that is 102.01 plus 0.0104 millimeter. This is the upper limit of the workpiece. And then we have another setting master for to set the lower limit of the workpiece. So again, the basic size is 102.01 millimeter. And this particular setting master is used to set the lower limit, that is 102.01 minus 0.0094 millimeter, which is the lower limit of the workpiece. And then the amplifier or indicators are essentially required. Now this photograph shows a flow meter, a rotameter. This is a tapered inside surface of this flow meter is tapered like this. Now this is the shape of the flow meter. So inside it is tapered, and then a scale, graduated scale, is engraved on the outer surface of the glass tube, and then we have a float which will float inside the tapered tube. This is a metallic float. Now when the gap between the work surface and the gauge reduces, airflow reduces and float level will come down. So it will indicate that the dimension being checked is small. Now when the gap increases, airflow is more, so the float level increases, which will indicate that the dimensional feature is the dimension of this particular feature is more. So we can always set two limits, upper limit and lower limit, using the setting masters. So when the float crosses the upper limit or lower limit, then the workpiece is rejected. Now let us see the working of an air gauge operators. Now we are observing the honing operation. The workpiece is clamped and the honing tool is inserted into the bore of the workpiece. The honing tool is adjusted. Now the machine is started. The honing tool is reciprocating and rotating. These reciprocation rate and rotation rates can be adjusted depending upon the surface finish required. Now the operator is removing the workpiece. You can see the coolant flow, lubricant flow. Now the honed surface is visually inspected for the finish. Now we are observing the pressure regulator and filter. You can see the pressure indicator. Using this, we can set the working pressure to required pressure, like 3 bar, 4 bar or 5 bar. Now this green area indicates the pressure range in which the air gauge can be used. Now we are observing an indicator which shows the size variation in terms of microns. So one small division is 1 micron. When we insert the plug gauge into the bore of the workpiece, depending upon the clearance between the workpiece surface and the plug gauge, the pointer will move and we can note down the reading. Now we can observe the operator is inserting the plug gauge into the bore, is rotating the workpiece or gauge to check for roundness, and vertical movement to check the cylindricity of the bore. Now we can observe the air plug gauge, air jet through which air escapes. In the opposite direction we have air jets. Now we can see the air connection. Via the air gauge, the air will flow and it will enter into the air plug gauge. Now holes are provided in the air plug gauge to reduce the weight of the plug gauge. you can set the air gauge. So initial calibration we have to do using the masters, and we can set the limiters. We can observe two limiters are there. We can set these limiters to indicate upper limit and lower limit of the bore size. Now the plug gauge is being inserted into the workpiece. Now operator is rotating the workpiece. He is removing the plug gauge. So now we can observe the two masters for initial calibration of the air gauge. So this is plus 0.0104 millimeter from the desired size, and this is on the lower side minus 0.0094 millimeter. Now we are observing the indicator removed from the air gauge setup. You can see the plunger. When the plunger is moved, the pointer rotates. We can see the range 0 to 50 microns on both sides, clockwise as well as anticlockwise. Now this is the place where the indicator should be inserted. Now the operator is inserting the indicator, and then using masters we can set the indicator. Now let us study a commercially available pneumatic comparator, which is known as Solex gauge, produced by Solex company. So this Solex company has developed a single and multiple dimensional measuring system. That means a single dimension can be measured at a time, or multiple dimensions can be compared at simultaneously. These highly versatile systems can be used in many industries, such as automotive industries and manufacturing industries, pharmaceuticals and food industries, etc. They work on the principle of pressure difference generated by the airflow. That is, back pressure is a measure which will indicate about the size of the workpiece. The air is supplied at constant pressure through the orifice, and the air escapes in the form of jets through the restricted space, which exerts a back pressure in the system. The variation in the back pressure is then used to find the dimensions of the components. Now let us study how the Solex gauge works. Compressed air is supplied to the system. The pressure of the air will be equal to water head H. We can see here we have a tank here filled with water to a certain level, and this H indicates the air pressure. This value of this pressure can be varied by adjusting the depth of dip tube in the water tank. So we can adjust the depth, and then we can adjust the pressure in the system. And then excess air escapes in the form of bubbles, which we can observe here. The controlled amount of air is passed through the orifice. So we have an orifice here, and it is connected to the gauging head. The controlled air is connected to the gauging head via the flexible tubes. Due to the restricted area between the gauging head and the workpiece, say for example at position A1, the back pressure H is developed. Because of the restriction here, the back pressure H is developed, which indicates the size of the dimensional feature. For example, diameter, the whole diameter in this case. Now we can also determine the roundness of the job and then cylindricity of the job using this system. To determine the roundness of the job, the workpiece is rotated along the jet axis. So this is the jet axis, and the workpiece is rotated. If there is no variation in pressure reading H, when the job is rotated, it indicates that the workpiece is perfectly round at this particular position. So similarly, this procedure is repeated at different positions along the length of the hole, A2, A3, A4, etc. And then we can note down what is the roundness at different positions of the workpiece. Similarly, we can measure the cylindricity of the workpieces. The diameter is measured at various positions A1, A2, A3, A4, etc., which will give the information about the cylindricity. For example, so we have a workpiece, the axis of the workpiece, and then so we are using the gauging head to check the diameter. Now we insert the gauge here, and then what is the reading H at this position A1 is noted down. Then gauge is moved, and then reading is taken at position A2, and then at A3, like this, at different positions the reading H is taken. If there is any variation, that will indicate whether the hole or the workpiece is tapered or double tapered like this, or the bore is barrel shaped or bell mouth shaped. So such cylindrical features we can check using these gauges. Now let us study why two jets are, we can observe here, two jets are used in this particular gauging head. What happens if we use a single jet? Now you can observe here, this is the workpiece part being inspected, and the gauging head, or it's also known as the spindle with single jet. Now when the spindle is rotated, keeping the job fixed, this clearance is varying from angular position to angular position. So because of this, the float will move up and down. So this will indicate that the diameter is varying from angular position to angular position. Even though the inside bore is round, because of this use of single jet, since the float moves up and down, so it will give a false information about the roundness of this bore. Now what happens if we use a double jet in the opposite faces? So when we rotate the spindle with the two opposite jets, the sum A plus B, this clearance and this clearance, or this clearance and this clearance, sum of A plus B will remain constant at any angular position. So the float remains constant. So when the spindle is rotated, this will not move up and down because the summation A plus B remains constant. So it will indicate that the hole is round. So this is the advantage of using the dual opposite jets. It will give the correct information about roundness of the bores. Now let us study what are the important characteristics of air gauging. The air gauging operators are available with very high magnifications or amplifications, as high as 10,000 times. It can be used to measure the parameters like diameters, length of the component, squareness, parallelism, concentricity, taper measurement is possible, center distance between two holes also can be checked using the air gauging. As there is no physical contact between the gauging head and the work part, the accuracy will not be lost because of the gauge wear. For this reason, air spindle and air snap gauges last very long. Also, very soft parts can be gauged without any chances of getting scratched. The internal dimensions of the components can be readily measured. not only with respect to the tolerance limits, but also with respect to the geometric form, geometrical aspects such as taper, straightness, camber and bell mouth can be easily checked. These air gauges, they are independent of operator skill. Any unskilled operator can easily use these air gauges for checking the components. High pressure air gauging can be done with cleansing of the parts, which helps to eliminate errors due to the dirt and foreign matter. Gauging pressures can be kept sufficiently low as some 3 bar or 4 bar to prevent part deflection. In general, high pressure gauges are suitable for those parts in which tolerance are relatively large, and low pressure air gauges are preferable for highly precise work. Dimensional variations throughout the length of shaft or cylinder bore can be explored for out of roundness, taperness, concentricity and similar other conditions. That means if we have a cylinder bore like this, we can insert the air gauges into the bore, and the bore can be checked throughout the length for circularity errors, taperness, concentricity, etc. Not only it measures the actual size, but it can also be used for salvage of oversized work pieces, for rework or to sort out for selective assembly. That is, pneumatic gauging is very much suitable for variable inspection, that is for the measurement of size, and also for attribute inspection to segregate the work pieces into acceptable and unacceptable work pieces. Now let us study what are the advantages of pneumatic comparators. The gauging member does not come in contact with the part to be measured, and hence practically there is no wear of the gauging member. Also, there are no chances of scratches on the surface of the workpiece. It has usually very small number of moving parts. Thus, the accuracy is more due to less friction and less inertia. Measuring pressure is very small. It can be as low as some 3 to 4 bar, and the jet of air helps for cleaning of the work surfaces. We can also have a very high magnification, as high as 10,000 times. The indicating instrument can be removed from the measuring unit. These air gauges are very much suitable for measuring diameter of holes where the diameter is very small compared with the length. For example, deep holes like gun barrels can be easily checked with these gauges. It is possibly the best method for detecting the ovality and taperness of circular bores. So we can check whether there is any taperness or some bell mouth shape or some barrel shape in the hole. So such things can be easily checked using these air gauges. A row of multiple column amplifiers can be scanned in one glance. So you can see here many column amplifiers are available, and we can observe the reading, multiple readings or multiple features of the workpiece at a time, so that the workpieces can be checked with can be checked at a faster rate. That means the checking time or inspection time can be greatly reduced by using multiple gauging. These amplifiers, they provide a visual representation of the checked feature. It permits the operator to take readings quickly and accurately. Either back pressure system can be used, or flow systems which uses flow meter tubes can be used for visual representation. And parallel stacking of columns or flow meter tubes puts all the readouts into the same vertical relationship, making comparison very much simpler. For example, multiple dimensions like this can be checked using multiple gauging operators, and their relationship can be easily understood by using multiple amplifiers. Relationships, for example, squareness can be easily checked using air gauges. For example, say we have a bore like this, whether this bore is perpendicular to the face, such features can be easily checked. Air gauging is very much economical. Once the basic system is purchased, relatively inexpensive additional tooling such as the gauging heads can be purchased and used for a wide variety of applications. Since air gauge tooling has less moving parts, and most of the cases no moving parts, it is virtually immune to trapping. That means the gauge will not get trapped in the work part. Now let us study what are the disadvantages of air gauging systems. It requires a very elaborate auxiliary equipment such as pressure gauges are required, pressure regulators are required, air filters are needed for filtering the dust particles. So like this, it requires elaborate auxiliary equipment. The scale is not generally uniform. When indicating device is the glass tube, for example a manometer, then a very high magnification is necessary in order to avoid the meniscus errors. The apparatus is not easily portable. Since it is bulky, it should be placed at one place, and is rather elaborate for many industrial applications. Now, different gauging heads are required for different dimensions. For example, when the bore size changes, we have to have a different set of gauging heads. For example, for 10 mm bore size, we need one gauging head, and for 12 mm bore size, we need another gauging head. So like this, as the dimension changes, we need to purchase the necessary gauging heads. The accuracy may be influenced by the surface roughness of the component which is being checked. That means the surface roughness will also affect the reading. They are very sensitive to temperature and humidity changes, so we sometimes it becomes necessary to control the working environment where the air gauges are used. Now let us study what are the various applications of air gauging. These air gauges, they are used for dimensional control of aerosol spray nozzle, and they are used to control the gun barrels. They are also used to control the dimensions of knee prosthesis. They are very much used for dimensional control of mechanical parts, such as bore size and bore shape faults can be detected. That means straightness of tubes for hydraulic cylinders. For example, we have an hydraulic cylinder with a bore. So whether the bore is straight or whether the bore is perpendicular with respect to face or not, such things can be checked. They are used to check the car shock absorbers and perpendicularity of the bore to face. So such features can be easily checked using air gauges. And dimensional control of mechanical parts such as engine cylinder linings can be checked. Engine cylinder linings can be checked. These engine cylinder internal surfaces they require very good and fine surface, and no scratches should appear on the internal surface of the liners. So in such cases, since the air gauge is non-contact type, they are very much used to inspect the lining, cylinder lining internal surfaces. Now it is possible to measure the multiple bores at a time, and distance of the bore from a face. For example, we have a bore and then we have a surface here. So what is the distance between this surface and the bore? Distance between bore and this face can be checked, and it is possible to measure the average diameter by having multiple jets. It is possible to get the average size of the bore. And these air gauges, they are used for inspection of castings, injection molded or welded parts, tanks, pipings, and hydraulic nozzles and brake system components are checked by using air gauges. They are also used to check spark plugs, gas appliance valves, solenoid valves, tire valves, stationary and rotating joints, etc. Testing of carburetor and gas appliance jets, injectors, injection molding nozzles are checked by using air gauges. Burners and nozzles are checked. Shock absorber nozzles are checked by air gauges. Cast iron and injection molded transfer canals, outlets of complex bores are easily checked by air gauging systems. And mean diameters of extruded tubes, cigarettes, etc., they are inspected by using air gauges. Adjustment of pneumatic and hydraulic operators, needle regulating flaps and piston cylinder play, such things are checked by using air gauges. So in this picture, we can see a cigarette gauge. Cigarette is placed here and it is checked for its dimensions. Now you can see some of the applications. What is the height of the component can be easily checked by using air gauges, and we can check whether the plate is straight or not, whether there is any curvature in the surface. Such things can be checked. And here we can see a system wherein we can easily check the squareness of bore to face, whether this bore is perpendicular to the face can be checked. And the squareness, whether this vertical surface is square with the bottom surface, such things can be checked. And then what is the depth of bore in the depth of blind hole in the workpiece can be easily checked. and tubing's tightness can be checked by inserting the gauging head into the tube, and short bore squareness can be checked, outside diameters can be easily checked, squareness of the bore, width of the face can be checked, taper in the component can be checked, the flatness, groove width, inside diameter, outside diameter, such things can be easily checked using air gauges. And this shows a system wherein 2 point out of roundness can be checked, and here it is 3 point out of roundness can be checked. Now you can see here the measurement of groove width. So this what is the groove width can be easily checked using air gauges, and this is a air plug for measuring the taper. You can see the jets, air jets here, and the connections, ports for connecting the pressurized air. And this shows two nozzle air plug. So there will be two nozzles in the opposite sides with masters. One master to set upper limit and another master to set the lower limit of the component. So this set can be used for measuring the inside diameter in the component. Now custom made gauges are available based upon the particular application. These air gauges are made, and you can have plug gauges and also ring gauges which can be manufactured as per the specifications. So taper air jet ring gauges can be made, multi diameter air jet ring gauges can be made for simultaneous measurement of several concentric bores. So we can see here hand caliper gauges, so adjustable hand caliper gauges. We can keep the workpiece here and we can check whether the size is okay or not. So these are adjustable hand caliper gauges. They are available with they can be made in different sizes, 5 to 38 millimeter size, 32 to 68. So like this, with different ranges these can be manufactured. And you can see here air ring gauges for measurement of external diameter. So we can see the port for connecting compressed air, and you can see the jets here, air jets. So workpiece can be inserted and the external size measurement can be easily made. Now this shows air ring with guide post for guiding the gauge. Now here you can see a special type of air gauging system wherein inside we have two portions. One is the outside portion, outside ring, which is made out of aluminium outer ring, and inside portion is made out of carbide inner ring. So this outer ring is made by aluminium to reduce the weight of the gauge. Now for external measurement of the external feature measurement, U-block gauges are available. So they will be like this. So this is the body of U-block gauge. And this is the table on which the workpiece can be mounted. And here we have jets. So we can have jet here. So where air will escape, and air connection can be made here. And here we can place the workpiece. Depending upon the clearance, we can get the reading from the floor position. or if we are using a back pressure type, the pressure gauge will indicate what is the size. So this is a U block gauge, air gauge for external feature measurement. Now you can see some air plug gauges for internal measurement here. So these plug gauges, they are inserted into the bore and air escapes here. Depending upon the clearance, we can get the reading. So the air plug gauges with different sizes are available, and we can have air plug gauges in this range 3 to 160 millimeter. Even bigger size gauges are available. We can see a special air plug gauge. So we have split type air plug gauge, so wherein the weight of the plug gauge can be reduced. Accuracy between 25 to 200 micrometer is possible with such air plug gauges. Now let us study about another type of comparator, which is known as fluid displacement comparator. So we can see the construction of fluid displacement comparator in this diagram. There is a chamber in which low viscosity liquid is filled. One end of the fluid chamber is having a diaphragm to which a plunger is fixed. At the other end of the fluid chamber, we have a fine bore capillary tube. When the diaphragm deflects, the liquid rises in the capillary tube, and there is a scale to note down the level of liquid in the capillary tube. We can also have two pointers to indicate upper limit of the workpiece and lower limit of the workpiece. Now during usage of fluid displacement comparator, what we have to do is we have to insert the workpiece between the table and the plunger. Depending upon the actual size of the workpiece, whether it is greater than the desired size or lower than the desired size, this plunger will move up and down. Accordingly, the liquid level in the capillary tube will rise or fall. Now, if the workpiece size is equal to the desired size, then the level of the liquid in the capillary tube in the tube will be in the middle position to indicate that that is the desired position. That means the deviation of the workpiece from the desired size is zero. Now, when the size of the workpiece is smaller than the desired size, then the plunger will move down, and the capillary the level of liquid in the capillary tube will move down. If the size of the workpiece is greater than the desired size, then the liquid level in the capillary tube will move up. If the liquid level in the capillary tube is beyond the upper limit or lower than the lower limit, then the workpiece is rejected. Now the magnification of such a system is a chamber cross-sectional area divided by capillary tube cross-sectional area. By adjusting these values, we can construct a fluid displacement comparator of the desired magnification. Now let us study what are the various applications of fluid displacement comparator. So these comparators are used in mass production for quick inspection. The operators will insert the workpieces between plunger and table, and then they will just observe what is the level of liquid in the capillary tube, and then they take the decision whether the workpiece is acceptable or not. It can be used as a laboratory standard from which working gauges or inspection gauges can be set. These fluid displacement comparators are used for inspecting newly purchased gauges. They can also be used as working gauges to prevent workpiece spoilage during the manufacturing of the workpieces to maintain the required tolerances on the workpieces. These can be used in selective assembly of parts, where parts are graded in three or more groups depending upon their tolerance. Now let us conclude the module 10, lecture 3. In this lecture, we discussed about the different aspects of pneumatic comparators. We discussed about the need of air gauging systems and working principle of air gauging systems. We also discussed about the different circuits used in air gauges, such as back pressure circuit or the fluid flow circuit. We also discussed about the various components used in the air gauging systems, such as amplifiers, and then different types of gauges and different types of amplifying systems. And we also discussed about a commercially available Solex gauge system. We discussed about the various important characteristics of air gauging systems, what are the advantages and disadvantages of the air gauging systems. We also discussed about the various applications of air gauging systems in the different fields, like manufacturing field, and how they can be used to check prosthetic toolings. Also we discussed like air plug and ring gauges. We also saw about the fluid displacement comparator and what are the uses of fluid displacement comparator. So with this we will conclude module 10, lecture 3. Thank you.